No, it's like a television, you know, when have this life.
It's really
yeah.
funny.
Yeah, I know this situation is. Okay, now I think we should be online. It's already. It's already 8 p.m. Tbilisi time and 6 p.m. Milan time, where I am right now, and 7 p.m. Stavros time in Athens, where he is right now. So I think we're not live yet. Okay, not yet, but anyways. It will start in 1 minute, probably. So now I'm in a pavilion, which is called Deco.
Mm-hmm.
And there's two like identical pavilions in Milan and in Tbilisi installed. So it's a blue space. And there will be a different speakers every day. So tomorrow it's the official opening.
Mm-hmm.
And the Tbilisi Biennial has opened today in Tbilisi, like in the same pavilion. So I think now we're live. So good evening, everyone. I'm speaking from Milan, where I am in one of the pavilions of the second edition of Tbilisi Architectural Biennial, Deco. We just had an opening from Tbilisi live, and we are really happy to finally open our first second edition. And we are really, really happy that our first guest is Professor Stavros Tavridis from Athens. Stavros is a professor at the School of Architecture in the Technical National University of Athens. And Stavros is known as an urban activist of especially urban commons. So I will give the floor to Stavros, who will tell us a bit about the topic, and he will give us a lecture with the title Reclaiming the City Through the Urban Commoning. And afterwards, we will open a discussion with the audience as well. So floor is yours, Stavros, and thank you very much for joining us. So
thank you so much. Really, really a pleasure and an honor to be with you. In these difficult times, it's a way of crossing borders. However, the problems are very strong and really threatening everywhere. So let us try to bridge these gaps through our talks and through our exchanges, commoning in spite of the pandemic. All right. So let me share my screen so that you can somehow follow my presentation. So my contribution to this beautiful series of events would be a talk concerning ways in which the city can actually be reclaimed as a common good. And as we will see soon, this is not only an issue that has to do with reclaiming a certain thing, a certain entity, a certain product, a certain good, but it's actually a process through which people actually are being transformed. It's a process through which space, which interests us, of course, a lot, is being transformed. And through these transformations, actually, new forms of social organization may indeed emerge. So let us try to agree on certain things that might help us kind of follow this argument. And of course, I'm absolutely open to your questions and your perhaps your disagreement. So I think, first of all, the use of the verb instead of the of commons as a specific description of things is important. So commoning, which is a verb, is actually describes a process through which different societies actually practice, but also choose what to do in order to describe what is to be shared and how. So this is a process that involves choices, it involves values, it also involves specific subjects of action that may emerge through this process. That is why I strongly believe and I suggest that we take this as a starting point of our discussion, that commoning practices are not only forms, means through which people do things, kind of patterns of action, but they are also ways in which subjects are being shaped. Let us consider the possibility of commoning practices actually shaping subjects, not pre-existing subjects, not subjects that had their own characteristics that you just employ them in order to participate in a process. These subjects of commoning are actually shaped, molded, if you want, through their participation in commoning. And thus, I would suggest that we can learn from different, let's say, problematizations of sharing that come from Latin America. As you will see, many of my examples refer to Latin American experiences. And these problematizations actually try to understand again community, but not the way we know it as a closed, let's say, group of people that share certain things and certain values and, in many cases, a certain pattern of practices, but mostly as an horizon of intelligibility, as Gustavo Esteva suggests. He's a very important thinker coming from Latin America, from Mexico. And on this horizon of an intelligibility, he suggests to use as a better form, as a better way of describing it, the word comunalidad. It's a Spanish word, but it tries to describe experiences that have to do with indigenous populations of Latin America. And in these experiences, it's not simply a community, but it's a kind of experiencing the world as a we. It's important to remember that in certain languages, in Mexico, for example, indigenous languages, there is no word for I. It's only a word for we, okay? So it's part of this tradition to understand the word in the trajectory of participation to a commonality. And then we can see some cases, some images that might remind us what it means to be part of this kind of we. It can be a temporary condition, like an informal market in Mexico. But it can also be a feast, like the way the Brazilians know how to do it. Participation, sharing space, sharing something which is common is produced in the process. And then it can be something more difficult and more important, helping others. This is an image after the recent earthquake in Mexico. In this case, sharing space, collaborating through the sharing of space is a very important way of showing how an ad hoc community, that is a comunalidad, can actually support those in need. You can see that these are chains of people that try to free people from the debris of the earthquake. So then we can somehow extend our discussion to the issue of space. Can we talk about common space? Can we talk about a kind of space or a process through which a kind of space emerges that has to do with sharing, the way that we described sharing as commoning? I think we can talk about common space as a way of producing a common ground, common areas in which people not only share things, but they learn how to produce the conditions of sharing. And I believe strongly that this kind of space is not located only in a certain place. It can only exist through a continuous process of expanding, a continuous process of somehow fighting against all possible enclosures. That's why I suggest for us to use the word, the image of threshold in order to understand common space. What is a threshold? It's an in-between space. It's a passage from one space to another. Its own identity depends on this kind of intermediation, this kind of in-betweenness. That's why it can transfer its characteristics to the idea of common space, because what common space is actually a space that establishes participation and sharing through two important processes. The first one is establishing comparison. It inaugurates a comparison between different people, different areas, different practices, different scopes in certain cases. This comparison is always in the making. It creates the common ground which is necessary for sharing without eliminating differences. And that's important to understand if we want to understand the specificity of common space. Common space is not the space shared by those who are the same, those who are identical, those who have the same identity. Common space is particularly important as an area in which different people meet and negotiate what they have in common, therefore actually produce themselves this common ground. And at the same time, it's a process of translation, because in common space, there is a constant, let's say, to and fro, from one side to the other, like as if this area, this in-between area, is always in the making as an area of translation, an area of translating needs, values from one person or from one group to another. And as we know in languages, the translation from one language to another is a never-ending process. Of course, we decide sometime that this is it. I can somehow make correspondences between one language and the other in the process of trying to go beyond the barriers of different languages. But at the same time, I understand that something is lost in translation. Something does not pass from one language to the other. So let us find common space as a continuous effort to establish common ground, although we know that always something will be outside, something will be an excess, something will be difficult to transmit, difficult to share in the end. So sharing is a process, it needs an effort, it needs a kind of belief that you can establish this common ground, even though we know as a kind of starting point that a complete sharing is never possible. So let us try to see in this case, therefore, what common space is not. The first is quite obvious. Common space is not private space. But let us not forget that there are certain elements, let's say molecules of common space, that can emerge from experiences of private space. For example, family spaces may become kind of, let's say, molecules of a potential commoning. If families, of course, are not simply the hierarchical universe that we know in many cases, and if families are more or less small, let's say, elements, particles that somehow distribute inside of them equally resources and distribute needs and aspirations. Therefore, common space is not private space, but it is not also public space. Because public space historically has always been connected to a certain authority, which describes its rules of use, produces this kind of space, and checks, controls. Of course, there are differences. Not all authorities are the same. We cannot equate the public space of an autocratic, let's say, government like Nazi Germany or fascist Italy with the public space of the early Italian cities, the early democratic Italian cities, or the democratic space of various cities and states connected, for example, to a kind of democratic deliberation that produces certain choices to a certain extent, and so on. So common space is not public space, because as we will see, it does not emerge from the dictates, from the choices of a certain authority. It emerges from the people themselves who are willing, who have decided actually to use it in common. And last but not least, let us not kind of confuse common space with communal space. Communal or community spaces are very, very important. Nobody will doubt that. But unless those communities who are actually produce those spaces are not open to outsiders, are not open to newcomers, are not opening the borders of their production to others to be included and be also considered as co-producers of this space, this space is bound to become a new kind of enclosure. Okay? And we know communities, of course, that they may share a lot of things inside, but provided that those others outside would not be part of this sharing. So let us not forget that common space emerges from below, from those who need it, from those who are willing to create the rules and conditions of use, and from those who are actually, from the beginning, accepting the prospect of expanding this space to include others. And last but not least of my suggestions, lots of my material is images after that, is to somehow understand or suggest a way of understanding the way architecture or generally space production and space design, the design of space, can be connected to common space. I think there are three levels on which we can connect architecture to common space or the production of space to common space. First of all, of course, as we know, producing spatial relations is one of the most important aspects of space production. Organizing different spatial relations has to do, of course, with architecture and planning. But the way we organize spatial relations can affect the potentialities of common space. If those organized spatial relations somehow encourage negotiations, if somehow those organized spatial relations give this space the characteristics of threshold, this can be a kind of potentiality that might produce common space. No guarantee, of course, for that, but it, at least it becomes a kind of challenge, a kind of condition that may produce relations of commoning. Then, of course, it's another level that has to do with expression, the expression of values. Spaces that can be considered common might be more also focused on expressing the values of commoning. It's not simply giving ground to practices of commoning, it's also expressing. And as we will see, expressing the values of commoning in many cases, in many parts of the world, in many ways of producing space are extremely important. It has a kind of value of declaration, but also a value of education, if you want. And last, of course, common space, since it is produced through material conditions, it's not just an image or a vision. It has to do with forms of labor and forms of collaboration. It's important to observe how forms of collaboration that exist in many different parts of the world. They have different names, like Ayuda Mutua in Argentina, and Uruguay, Mucirao in Brazil, as we would see, Ubuntu in Africa, and so on and so forth. These forms of collaboration, mostly strongly rooted in rural conditions, in rural forms of cohabitation, in rural forms of working together in order to cope with difficult situations. So collaboration comes from below as a necessity, not as an ideology. So yes, indeed, those relations can become an integral part of commoning. So common space is important the way it is formed, the way it is produced, and the way it expresses the values of commoning. Let us therefore see a few cases in which the appropriation and sharing of public space can indeed produce glimpses of common space. Some examples from Europe. El Campo de Cebada is an appropriated public space, an empty lot that was appropriated by a neighborhood committee, a neighborhood initiative, that produced a space in which people could actually do things, could actually employ their inventiveness. And let me stress upon this effect, this area, this issue, this point, okay? Inventiveness goes hand in hand with commoning. Unless people are motivated and allowed to invent, commoning practices will never emerge. You cannot make commoners. So Cabo de Cebada is actually a place in which this inventiveness took specific forms, arrangements of space, materialities of space that had to do with recycling, and at the same time, a beautiful inventiveness that had to do with the very molecule of space, which is, of course, urban furniture. You can understand that architects or artists were involved in this process, but on the other hand, people were actually contributing by judging those constructions, those small experiments of urban furniture, in order to judge and actually proclaim what parts of these experimentations were important for commoning. And then we have Prinzessinnengarten in Berlin, which is also an important place. You can see it from above. It's actually a garden, an occupied place, tolerated by the local authorities so far, but constantly in struggle to preserve and extend this process. And one of the important issues, something that we can learn, for example, from Prinzessinnengarten, is the fact that the construction of innovative spaces or innovative spatialities, if you want, is extremely important for the emergence of conditions of sharing. So this is merely a scaffold. And of course, in front of it is an urban gardening installation. But then this scaffold became a kind of shared furniture, a kind of changeable and appropriatable furniture through which people could organize various events, participate in talks, and so on and so forth. So we can see that there is a kind of element in the appropriation of public spaces and the production of public spaces as commons. There's a kind of important element that we should observe, which is the possibility of inventiveness that would create things in this space, temporary or less temporary ones, nevertheless, materially existing. And then this is the case of an occupied municipal market in Athens, which for several years has been a place in which people were actually organizing events, but also a small organic market. So the reuse of materials, the reuse of furniture is also an important factor here. And then, of course, a more complicated and perhaps more indicative example experiment is the case of Sidesi in San Cristobal de las Casas in Mexico, where you have what they call an indigenous university, created from scratch in the outskirts of San Cristobal de las Casas. It just expresses its own values through its layout, through its plan, but also it includes areas in which materials, conditions of design, and conditions of spatial arrangement participate equally in the production of common space. This is a common mill area. You can, of course, you know that common mills are extremely important in shaping subjects of commoning. And in many cases, this is the word that is used in languages that in order to describe comrades, compañeros, síndrofe in Greek is the, those who actually eat food together. And this is a workshop of graffiti in this area. One point more. We can even think of housing as an area of commoning, as an area in which common spaces may be produced. It might seem strange because we usually connect housing with areas of privacy, with areas of private ownership, with areas of somehow separation of different families, which no matter how close they live, they really don't share anything. They just cross the same corridors or the same staircases or the same pathways in order to reach their apartments. But in most cases, because of the layout and of the conditions of the societies that we live in, these are not enough in order to create a kind of shared space. I believe that we can learn from examples that mostly come from Latin America. It's an area in which I've done a lot of research. One can find in many other places examples, but these are the examples that I know and I have really experienced. So really trust me that these are examples that we can somehow discuss and connect to without taking them as models. Huh? They are just examples that can teach us certain lessons about the process of commoning. So the first one comes from Montevideo in Uruguay. The Uruguayan Federation of Housing Associations through Mutual Help, Ayuda Mutua in Spanish, is a very important point of reference for Latin America in general, because this federation has emerged many years ago. It has contributed a lot to struggles against the local dictatorship. It has empowered people in their fight for the right to housing and the right to the city. And it has actually mobilized people through this extremely important idea, the idea that the production of shared space will come, of shared, let's say, housing areas, will come through practices of mutual help. Three characteristics of cooperativism as emerging in the Uruguayan case. First of all, the importance of the tradition of self-management. This is not a simple tradition. It's a tradition that it has its elements in many parts of the world. It has its different histories in many parts of the world, but in its essence means a very simple thing. We take decisions jointly and we respect each other's opinion through processes that allow us to reach agreements, okay? No one from outside, no one from above will tell us how to shape our common ground. Second aspect, which is also important for the whole Latin America, is a tradition of mutual help. It happens a lot in informal settlements, in favelas, in villas miserias, as they call them in Argentina. In many places of the world, there are this kind of traditional wisdom of helping each other, which is part of the construction of the social bond. It's not just an occasion. It's not just an opportunity to help. It's something that is taken for granted, something that is almost felt, inculcated in the bodies of people. We need to help each other in order to survive. We need to help each other in order to to collect the crops in order to be able to participate in the life of a community. And the third characteristic of this kind of cooperativism is the form of collective ownership. You know very well that commoning directly clashes with conditions of ownership. The definition of property in various areas of legality in our society are very strong and very strict. It's important that, at least in Uruguay, they have managed to somehow open a kind of space inside this legality and managed to accomplish the conditions of collective ownership. The associations of Uruguayan housing cooperatives are really based on collective ownership. And as Nahum says, who is one of the leaders of this federation, it's one of the oldest American traditions, okay? Collective ownership. The existence of areas which are collectively owned is a very important condition that used to be almost identified with indigenous culture and indigenous life. So, just quickly, some images from Fukvam. You can see them working together. You can see them struggling together for popular housing. You can see them voting in assemblies. So the choices, I was saying that the practices of producing common space are really producing subjects. So you can imagine that those people who are now involved in the production of their future houses, in voting on the conditions of managing this process, are not the same people who entered the association at the beginning. They are changing in the process of experiencing commoning practices. And of course, they celebrate when the houses are ready. Similar conditions, with not exactly the conditions of collective ownership, but on the other hand, important conditions of sharing have emerged in the Buenos Aires housing cooperatives of MOI. These are self-managed cooperatives. And you can see that the values above in the billboard are autogestion, which is self-management, propiedad colectiva, which is common property, collective property, and ayuda mutua, mutual help conditions. So these are the values which come again and again in the cooperativist movement in Latin America. And through those values, that it is not, as somebody says very clearly when describing the process, it is not simply ensuring housing. It is at the same time producing new forms of social organization, new forms of social bond, new forms of conditions through which subjects of action emerge. So again, a few images of the housing cooperatives in Buenos Aires, especially. MOI has also in other cities of Argentina. Just to give you an idea of the kinds of housing that they are building, at the beginning they started modifying existing houses, occupying areas in which were left as derelict and unused, and then pushing and managing to push the government to allow them to use those spaces, of course, after struggles that sometimes were really violent. Homeless movements in Brazil, what can we learn more about this process of sharing through commoning, through practices of participation, both in the production, in the maintenance, in the decisions that have to do with housing? Homeless movements in Brazil are really organized active movements. They participate both in the occupation of the land, in the design process, and in this they have one more, let's say, advantage. Technical assistance institutes are recognized groups of militant experts, recognized by the state, that is, who can really contribute and work together with homeless workers associations in order to produce innovative or new typologies and new complexes of social housing, housing actually funded by the state, but under conditions imposed by the associations, that is collective loans, loans that do not exert a pressure on individual members of the association. And the association is collectively responsible for paying back the loan. And the conditions of the loan are under the pressure of the movement actions and the movement struggles, therefore are very much favorable, very much supportive. Of course, all this is a kind of struggle that goes on, depends on the period, depends on the characteristics of the period. And of course, in Brazil, as in other places in the world, Mutirao tradition is important. It's a tradition of cooperation, which is based on exchanging skills, exchanging work hours, exchanging knowledges and materials in order to be part of this process. So this process actually creates a self-managed community and not simply a self-managed housing area. Quickly on that, it starts like that. It starts through an encampment, which is actually demanding a big piece of land to be used for social housing. In this ad hoc settlement, they have their own common area, their own meeting place, the place of the movement in which people actually keep on discussing about the ways that the future settlement will be built. And then, of course, when the technical assistants come, who are actually engaged militants, experts of various kinds, not only architects, but they are actually in support of the movement. They are not the experts who float above the society. They are the experts who have chosen sides. And those experts help people to actually shape opinions, not simply decide, but shape opinions in order to make this process actually to take place, actually to become a motivating force of common space production. You can see various ways in which they can teach people how to shape opinions, how to learn, how to understand, for example, the scale and expertise that architects usually have been trained to have. And then again, because people will also participate in the future houses, in the construction of the future houses, they learn how to work. They learn, they acquire certain skills in order to be part of this process. And then again, just a small indication of the importance of the result. This is a shared space. The balconies are part of a staircase well, but also part of individual apartments. This came out as an idea from the process of participation. It's a housing complex in São Paulo, of an association called Copromo. But also you can see cases in which the layout of the public area, let's say the common space outside the houses and the house buildings, is also importantly designed in order to house the practices of sharing. My last example comes from Mexico, where you have perhaps the most advanced case of housing as commons. These are the so-called autonomous neighborhoods of Mexico City, which are actually the product of a very strong and a very, persistent struggle of movements decided to create not only housing projects, as one of them says, but also communities. They even think of this process as a process of producing popular power, power of those who are kind of excluded from power. So popular power is the power that comes from below, and manages to produce new forms of social cohabitation, new forms and new ways of living together. And this is what they mean by saying autonomy. They don't mean autonomy as a secluded enclave of otherness. They mean autonomy as a production of new ways of expanding and open communities new ways of social organization that produce expanding communities. And this kind of process, actually, they describe it as autonomy, because in all the levels, in all the stages of the construction of those areas, participation is the quintessence of the collectivity, let's say. Okay, so participation has produced this kind of beautiful houses, these interesting houses. Why they are interesting? Because they are actually built under the let's say support and the conditions of the assembly deliberation, which are characteristics of the neighborhood. They are not houses simply designed by someone to fit into the needs of somebody else. They are the product of a process of exchanges, expert knowledge plus local knowledge, a kind of back and forth, a kind of to and fro, a kind of exchange that checks both knowledges, accepting that this process is a process which is always in the making, makes these neighborhoods really important in the creation of common space, because common space is not simply the space outside the house. See, for example, these small yards, they're having a perforated, let's say, envelope around them. What is this envelope? This envelope just is a result of a deliberation and lots of talks in the assemblies, how to mark the existence of an individual family yard as separated from the street. It's not to be completely separated. The women said in the assemblies, we need to watch the children. We need to be not somehow included and enclosed in a yard of our family. We need to have this kind of exchange, but also preserve elements of privacy. So no matter how one could judge this proposal and this plan and this materialization of the plan, this is indeed the result of a total process of participation, and it has to do with the specific forms through which people actually describe the life they want to live together. You can see some more images. And of course, the layout of another such autonomous neighborhood, I always show this slide, it speaks of itself. The names of the street are almost a declaration. Housing, dignity, education, information, independence, labor, justice, democracy, culture. You can see that these names of the streets are actually a manifesto of a new kind of life. A life which is based on the organization of a community, which is understood by them as a kind of catalyst that would change the city or change parts of the city. My final statements then, I believe that space can be considered as a potential. So if we talk about possible space, we are actually finding ways to test the values in which we somehow try to direct our efforts. The values of commoning should have this trial by space about which Lefebvre used to talk in the production space. Trial by space means that unless you check the values, unless you check the visions, unless you check the dreams through space, through spatial experiences and spatial arrangements, you cannot really believe that you are producing something new. You cannot really know how to check and how to somehow locate the problems of a possible different future. That is why performing space, performing through space, is a process of creating potentiality. It's a process of expanding the conditions of existing space to a different direction. And this is why, through the invention of spaces of commoning, we might actually hope that there is a kind of reinvention of society. Because these things, these experiments that I've shown you, these experiences that I've shown you, actually are not utopias designed by somebody and explained to others from a kind of enlightened avant-garde or whatever. These are practices which emerge in specific places and directly affect the lives of those involved in them. Thus, this is why those people change. They somehow not only become different, but also invite others, and thus become different because they connect, because they compare, because they are somehow in need of finding ways to translate. And that is why this process can really produce elements of a new value system, a value system which is might be based on equality, solidarity, and justice. But these are not words. These are kind of trajectories to which one can actually look for, to which one can actually follow in the process of creating commoning spaces. Would that mean eventually finding the ultimate element of sharing? And what would be the ultimate element of sharing? Being able to experience, being able to accept, being able to envision, being able to dream of the sharing of power. That is, being able to actually accomplish something which might be seen as paradoxical. To accept that we are all equal and at the same time fight that we become all equal. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Stavros. This was really an amazing and really, really interesting lecture and presentation by you. The examples that you showed are really very interesting, and all the time when I was listening to your presentation and looking at these images, like, I was always thinking about our local reality in Georgia as well. So I thought, yeah, it's such a pity that we couldn't manage to bring you there this time. And we really hope that soon it will be possible that you will also visit us in Georgia and get familiar with the topics that are happening there, because I think there are a lot of topics that might be very relevant mm-hmm. to the examples that you were showing us right now. So I wanted to ask you maybe two questions, and then we can see if there are questions from the audience. All the examples that you showed us and all the entire presentation and the topic, this is like really inspiring. It's a bit like kind of, it's not utopia, it's really happening, but it seems like really romantic, no? Like very positive. So my question would be, like, from your observations, your research, your studies, what is the main challenge of this process? When people come together and they share the space, they're in a commoning process. So have you observed something that is really challenging? And how can this kind of spaces not become also close to others? Mm-hmm. That would be my first question.
Well, yes, you can understand that these are indications of possibilities. There are no guarantees. There have never been guarantees in history. And we are responsible for opening the road. It's not that it exists simply and we have to follow it or not. So it is a process that involves, in many cases, a kind of active engagement. But on the other hand, and I would stress this point, it also involves acute needs. People discover in many places of the world the power of commoning, not out of ideology, but out of need. And this is extremely important to observe in many parts of the world. in our part of the world also, like in Europe, but also in Latin America, in Asia, in Africa, commoning may not even have a kind of direct translation to local, let's say, languages. It's also a word that emerged recently. It's a trendy word, perhaps. But on the other hand, it can describe conditions that people are familiar with in many parts of the world. And they have discovered that they are also conditions that produce life, that allow life to unfold, that allow, and they also produce joy in many cases. Many movements in Latin America organize feasts, not simply to celebrate a victory, but also to enhance and to produce and reproduce the bonds that are becoming important in the process of commoning. And this is where, of course, most of the issues arise. We know that the societies that are based on profit and exploitation create subjects of a certain kind. And allow me to say that these are crippled subjects because they are losing some of their skills of collaboration. They learn more to focus on their individual profit, individual, in general, I'm not talking about money only, I'm talking about also symbolic capital and so on and so forth. Therefore, in all of those examples that I've observed or taken part of, there was always the problem of transcending this kind of selves that we have learned to be, transcending the conditions through which we are always bombarded by images and values that focus on the individualism. Those people know it. In many cases, those people speak directly about it. They say, we don't simply fight for housing. We fight for a new kind of bond between people, which is based on solidarity, on accepting the other as other. So yes, these are the most important difficulties, to be able to transcend all these crippling, let's say, ideas and values that make it difficult for you to be part of a collective effort.
Yes, thank you. And another question that I would like to ask or to kind of open the topic, because when I contacted you, it was before the pandemic. So like you kind of also followed our process of how we had to reinvent our festival this year. And the challenges that we faced and how we had to transform it into a semi-digital format. My question would be like, the thing is that when we started discussing this topic of what do we have in common, it was before the pandemic. And when the pandemic started, we realized that our question was suddenly really, really relevant. So I was wondering, like, can also like a biennial, like we're organizing right now, or could like this kind of cultural event be also an act of some kind of commoning? Mm-hmm. Because this is actually what we argue from the first day when we established this platform, that we want to bring people together and bring them to start discussing about the problematic and critical topics in that emerge in our local situation in Tbilisi. So yeah, that would be my question to you.
Well, I totally agree with this effort to bring people together, although we are forced to stay alone take measures that protect each as an individual. It's a kind of rhetoric which is based on individual responsibility, which is always, you know, bouncing back to us as if we were responsible for what is happening or for the lack of policies that would somehow support societies from this pandemic. Because we know very well that these policies, because of the prioritizations of many governments, did not have the public health as an important issue. They rather chose to channel public money to other areas of social entrepreneurship and social conditions of reproduction. So many societies, the so-called advanced ones, but not only those, were left without protection. So the pandemic is not simply a disease, it's a social condition, and those who suffer most are the most vulnerable. Therefore, every effort that tries to establish bonds, that tries to establish relations, that tries to establish conditions of sharing, even though you have to need to use this kind of mediation of the internet, is important in reconstructing the tissue which is being destroyed, not by the pandemic, I insist, but by the choices made, which made the pandemic really a disaster. We know, for example, that in Italy or in other places in Europe, the fact that the industry never stopped working produced a kind of incubator of a pandemic. We know that for us and other countries based on tourism, expecting the tourism and the tourist flow in order to somehow work and fuel their economies, had to simply open everything, allow with no tests, with no nothing, the flow of people and the flow of transportation without the proper means and the proper conditions. We know that, for example, airplanes are also incubators. No distances there because it costs a lot for the airlines and so on and so forth. Therefore, I believe that this is an opportunity to declare that we will not leave anybody alone, that we will not consider creativity as stopped in this period, that we will consider art and architecture as means of constructing relations between people and not as means of gaining fame or money. And I think this is important to somehow distill it and instill it actually in the biennials of the world, to show that biennials can be meeting grounds, can produce common grounds, not because everybody is similar with everybody else, but exactly because we are different. We need these common meeting areas, and for the time being, we have to use the internet in order to create them. But let us not forget that this is a temporary ersatz for meetings, okay?
Yes, thank you, Stavros. And I'm checking now if there are some questions from the audience. Yeah, I would encourage the audience who are watching us right now to ask us questions. So I will read the question. So what is the importance of the scale of the community, all this? The experiences you presented can be very big, but always somehow limited in scale. How do you imagine that these models and values could be scaled up? Do you think this could happen through a multiplication of these experiences until a critical mass is reached?
I would say that this question is almost everywhere where I have my talks. I mean, everybody is anxious of understanding how we jump scales, and understandably so. It's an obvious and important question. We have experiences from which we can learn. We don't have rules. We need further to struggle for this expansion that could produce qualitative steps. One experience that I have in mind is, of course, the Zapatista experience in Mexico, where you have organized autonomous communities, you have common in practices that permeate education, health, production, and collective life. But this has produced a kind of network of communities, a kind of structure which is not based on a hierarchical center. It's not based on the idea of the state as we know it, as a coordinating, but in the final analysis, as a kind of controlling instrument. No, their production, their choice, their model, let's say, although they strongly suggest that we don't take them as a model, is a kind of society, a kind of area in which people can actually be part of the process of constructing what they need for their survival, what they need for their life, but also becoming educated in being part of the process of governing. They have a very kind of strange system of rotation in duties. They are so strict about it that they sometimes reach a kind of paradoxical, almost surrealistic condition. They change, for example, in the municipality of a certain communities, they change every 15 days or 20 days. So this, in terms of management, this is crazy. But in terms of educating people to govern by obeying, as they say, mandar obedeciendo, I think is the Spanish equivalent, is important in the creation of a different society. We're talking about 500,000 people. We're talking about a large area compared to certain states of small states of Europe. Is this enough? It's not. The hope is that this kind of arrangement will somehow metastasize, create networks of support all over the world. When and how this could happen, we don't know. But I think we can observe that we already have experiences and examples of jumping scales. We're not talking about a small occupied building which poses as the kind of huge example for the world to watch. We have lots of interconnected initiatives and also lots of initiatives that grow from people and from their needs, and not initiatives that grow from engaged activists. So we have a lot of work to do in order to observe, to support and expand those processes.
Okay, thank you, Stavros. I'm checking if there are any other questions from the audience. There are no more questions for now. So maybe I will ask you another question, if it's okay, if it's not too late for you and you have some time. Maybe to talk a bit about the pandemic situations, like have you observed specifically maybe in Athens, if like where you're locally based, if there were some kind of acts of solidarity or this kind of spaces formed which would allow people to help each other, for example, or like maybe you have some kind of example of this kind of happening?
Well, there have been in many places not only in Greece, but also in countries of Europe, in countries of Latin America, Africa, and many places, in cities in which you had this pressure from the pandemic, but also from the lockdown, you had responses in which people actually tried to help those who could not help themselves, or continue to live in a condition that reminded them that they are in a neighborhood and not in a kind of prison. So we know, of course, that the initiatives of Italians playing music in their balconies, we know initiatives that had to do with the collection of food for people who could not work, did not have lost their work during this period, and also for people who are most vulnerable, like old people, and could not even go to the supermarket to buy things. So these kinds of initiatives actually proliferated through the during the period of the lockdown, but they still remained as important nuclei of solidarity throughout the city in Athens, which is the city I live in. Interestingly, there have been also web pages trying to somehow offer a common ground for various initiatives, like informing all people what services are available for free in this period. How can you exchange services? I mean, supporting somebody and then getting support from him or her in a different area of need. So there has been a lot of things happening in this period. Of course, now that we are not in the condition lockdown, being limited to our houses, there are additional initiatives that have to do with the protection of our democratic rights under threat. We had recently, of course, the major trial of the Golden Dawn, the Nazi Party. It has been a very important demonstration waiting outside the court for the decision of the court, and it showed how people are actually not forgetting to support and help each other. I mean, everybody was wearing masks, everybody was taking care of the most, let's say, the older ones. Lots of young people were in the demonstration, but they were actually very observant about how to protect and how to respect the needs of others. All these things show that societies can feel a kind of almost freezing or numbing condition in which they don't know how to react, but they eventually find ways to demonstrate their appearance, to demonstrate their existence, to demonstrate and declare their needs. Because if we allow those in office, those in governments, to simply take the measures that they think are necessary for the continuation of the existence of the various economic priorities, then we will lose most of our rights, having to do with labor, having to do with access to health and public facilities and so on and so forth. So I think this is a difficult period, but this is a period that we should not forget that unless we develop forms of solidarity and struggle, we will not be allowed to return at least to the conditions that we were used to on the level of individual and collective rights.
Thank you very much, Stavros. I think there are no more questions from the audience. So I think slowly I would bring our conversation to the end. It's a very strange situation for me as well as a moderator to be sitting here. So we have an audience here, the team members of the pavilion, my little daughter who's here, and the museum is working year of the Triennale. We have the physical attendance in Georgia in the identical pavilion, and also the people online who are watching us. So I would use the opportunity here, because I think there are many people who are watching us right now, to thank you very, very much for joining us, for agreeing to give a lecture with us. It was extremely interesting. And from my side, I would like to thank the entire team, every single person who made this biennial happen in all the parts of the world. And without these people, it wouldn't be possible. And with all this common strength and work, this wouldn't be possible. And also, like, we have so many supporters. But I will mention our main supporter, which is Creative Europe. And they're supporting us the second time. So this also makes this whole project to be possible. So I am really excited for the next coming days. I hope you can follow us a bit as well.
Yes, and I will definitely do so. And thank you so much for this invitation. I wish I would be there, I mean, in physical presence, but this is difficult. And I really thank a lot all those who worked for this event. I'm sure that you will produce very important and interesting events in the coming days. And let us hope that we will meet sometime in the future, being present in the same place and with these people.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Stavros. We also hope the same, to be able to see you physically. So good night, and see you next time in a real space.
Good night. Thanks a lot.
So good night, and goodbye, everyone. Thanks for listening and watching. Bye.